The German 88mm gun, one of the most iconic artillery pieces of World War II, had a well-deserved reputation for deadly accuracy and destructive power. The versatile 88mm cannon, also known as the Flugabwehrkanone, meaning aircraft defense cannon, was Germany's main heavy anti-aircraft gun, and was soon shortened to Flak. The history of the German 88mm gun can be traced back to late 1916, when the German army initially modified the established German naval armament for ground operations in World War I. German weapons manufacturers, Krupp AG and Rheinmetall, had machinery for making both the barrels and the ammunition. Since Germany was forbidden by the Treaty of Versailles from producing large-caliber weapons, the Flak anti-aircraft guns were actually developed by Krupp, and subsequently built in partnership with Bofors of Sweden. The first prototypes, known as the Flak 18, were built in 1928 and were designed to be mounted on a cruciform gun carriage that allowed them to be aimed in any direction. The cannons were especially notable for their fast rate of fire, with the Flak 18 automatically ejecting expended cartridge cases and cocking the firing mechanism. The highly mobile axle bogies have the potential to lower the cruciform firing platform, allowing for more stable firing. The barrel could be rotated 360 degrees, and a trained gun crew could fire up to 20 rounds per minute, which was faster than comparable weapons of the time. The Flak 18 had a one-piece barrel with an estimated 900-round service life. Because of the short barrel life, barrels would have to be replaced on the field. Widespread production started with the Nazi rise to power in 1933, and the Flak 18 was available in small numbers when Germany intervened in the Spanish Civil War. It immediately proved to be the best anti-aircraft weapon available at the time. The Flak detachment with 88s proved accurate and flexible in combat against mostly land targets, owing to its high muzzle velocity and large caliber, which made it a superb long-range anti-vehicle and anti-bunker weapon. Each of a battery's four guns had targeting indicators attached to the central controller, enabling for synchronized fire. The gun layer's task with the automatic loading system was to keep the gun barrel trained on the target area based on the controller's instructions. While the gun layer targeted the weapon based on the data, the loaders would maintain the weapon fed with live ammunition that would fire immediately upon insertion. The experience in the Spanish Civil War prompted the Germans to improve the design as the Flak 36, which had a two-piece barrel for easier replacement of worn liners. The trailer design was also improved, making the setup and transport of the fixed guns easier. The use of the small sections of the inner tube in the Flak 36 eliminated what would have been severe maintenance, servicing, and field supply problems. The Flak 37 was a later model that incorporated upgraded instrumentation to allow the gun layers to easily follow commands from the single director. All three early 88 versions were 56 calibers long, which meant the barrel length was 56 times that of the 88mm caliber. The standard gun fired a 17-pound shrapnel grenade, capable of climbing thousands of feet into the air before exploding into 1,500 or more fragments, capable of damaging or destroying any plane within 200 yards. During World War II, instead of aiming directly at the aircraft, German cannons were used to fire an 88mm projectile that burst at altitude, ejecting jagged metal fragments, capable of tearing into the wings and fuselage of Allied aircraft, particularly bombers. When an 88mm shell made a direct hit on the thin-skinned aircraft, the outcome was severe, and the plane was typically destroyed. The airborne explosions also created a distinctive black cloud that hovered in the sky, alerting pilots to the presence of flak. The name, flak, quickly became a general term for ground anti-aircraft fire. The anti-aircraft rounds had two types of fuses: those with barometer fuses set to certain altitudes, and those with time-delayed fuses. Whatever triggered them, the sharp steel fragments could easily decapitate or dismember one or more aircraft crew members. Even for those who escaped the assault, the consequences of such an attack could be devastating. Air defense units were typically equipped with a commando-jarret fire control computer, or a portable Wurzburg radar, which was responsible for the high level of accuracy against aircraft. It allowed for incredibly precise fire, even taking into account the distance between the guns and from the aiming crew, canceling out the offset and aiming all weapons at the same point. Instead of having trained crews on each gun, this allowed several weapons to be properly targeted at the same target by a single command team of five men. The 88mm guns were used in an anti-tank role against French tanks during the early stages of the Second World War, and modified versions specifically built for an anti-tank role were first used in the North African campaign in 1941. The carriage's versatility allowed the 88mm flak to fire in a limited anti-tank mode while still on wheels, and it could be completely deployed in under 2.5 minutes. As the gun's application expanded, so did the variety of rounds used by the Germans. There are 19 different rounds listed in the German Ordnance Catalog from 1944, 8 of which were high-explosive rounds, and 7 of which were armor-piercing, with the remaining rounds being solid kinetic energy projectiles. The AP rounds were also deadly effective. Once the round had penetrated the target, a delayed percussion fuse with a tracer element at its base ignited a small bursting charge. The basic AP round employed chemical energy, rather than kinetic energy. With a jet formation of extremely high temperature that burnt its way into the target, the round employed the hollow charge theory to penetrate armor. The dreaded Tiger I tank used the majority of these rounds. The Germans were so impressed with the 88 that plans were made as early as 1936 to install it on a tank that would eventually become the Tiger I. While the German 88mm KWK-36 tank gun and anti-aircraft cannons had identical ballistics, the tank gun had a one-piece barrel and a thin jacket. The breech block, like other German tank guns, utilized a vertical sliding action rather than the horizontal sliding block used on anti-aircraft guns. The recoil system was unique, and there included a double baffle muzzle brake to reduce vehicle stress. The tank's trigger was moved from the breech block to the gunner's elevated hand wheel. The turret was hefty and well armored, adding to the tank's ponderous reputation. Except for the use of electrical primers that required a 12-volt car battery, the rounds were the same as those used on the Flak 18-37 family of anti-aircraft guns. Although only 92 rounds could be carried around and under the turret, crews frequently managed to store extra rounds. The 88's precision and range in the Tiger frequently resulted in a one-shot, one-kill ratio for the Germans versus Allied tanks and crews. The Germans also developed the 88 Pak 43 as a dedicated anti-tank weapon, with the first examples leaving the factory by the end of 1943. It soon became widely acknowledged as possibly the best all-around anti-tank gun of the war. It could easily deliver firepower in a full 360-degree traverse and pierce the frontal armor of any Allied tank on the battlefield. Most oncoming shots could well be deflected by the gun's characteristic, highly sloped front armor. The barrel was made in two sections, and the breech mechanism was semi-automatic. The gun's maximum range was 15,150 meters, allowing it to be utilized as a supporting field gun as well as an anti-tank weapon. The 88 Pak 43 was modified and mounted on the Tiger II tank. This fearsome tank was designed to carry 40 HE and 40 AP rounds, and it first saw action on the Eastern Front in early 1944. The Pak 43 was also used as a self-propelled gun in a range of configurations, notably the Nashorn or Rhinoceros, and the Ferdinand. The latter was pushed into service for the Battle of Kursk in 1943, with 89 reportedly being used. According to some sources, the Ferdinands destroyed 200 Soviet tanks despite initial design problems. The survivors of the fierce Kursk battle were extensively rebuilt, and redesignated the Elephant. The Pak 43 was also mounted on the Panzerjäger Panther, popularly known as the Jagdpanther, a fast-moving tank killer. It weighed 46 tons, had a capacity of 60 rounds, and could travel at a speed of 48 kilometers per hour. Fewer than the 425 units produced were delivered, but the Jagdpanther was put into service on all fronts, earning the Allies grudging respect. Surprisingly, both the United States and Britain had guns with anti-aircraft capabilities similar to the 88 Flak. The British 94mm and the American 90mm were both capable of firing higher and lofting heavier shells. Many argue that they could outperform the German gun on paper. Both weapons, however, were larger and heavier. The Allies limited those guns to their original anti-aircraft roles, whilst the Germans expanded the 88's function to anti-tank and against reinforced ground positions. This, in turn, sparked the development of other innovations including power rammers, fuse-setting tools, and improved ammunition handling systems, all of which greatly increased the weapon's versatility and effectiveness. The Germans' innovative and flexible approach to the first 88 Flak allowed them to study and adapt as the war progressed, enhancing the weapon's anti-aircraft fire capabilities and successfully adapting it for tank, anti-tank, and associated ground roles. This greatly contributed to the 88's long-lasting reputation as the legendary big gun of the Second World War. If you have enjoyed the video, please subscribe and support the channel for more. Many thanks for watching.